And here we go again, right? The weather. Always this time of the year we get this weather. Now, someone said earlier that we should be finished by 11:30, but I told him that I have an hour and a half sermon here. No, but I don't really. But anyway, you know, digging for it. You know, get it done, right? So, it shows real dedication, though, for the things of God that you've come out this morning. And I know some of you will agree, it's all about Jesus, right? Giving back and praise to the only one who deserves it. So will you bow with me in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 13 for those that wish to? And I'm just going to read the verses 4 to 8 from that. So if you don't want to, that's fine. I'm going to read it from here anyway. And also I'm going to read John 3:16, often referred to as the love chapter. It is often read during marriage ceremonies, so it's familiar to us. It is part of a letter written by the Apostle Paul to the Corinthian church. What was the reason for the letter? Well, Paul is one of God's messengers, and he received reports of trouble in the Corinthian church. These troubles included sexual immorality, jealousy, disagreements between church members, and church leaders refusing to teach its members. In this letter, which begins in chapter 1, Paul instructs the church in several areas, and I would recommend you read all of the chapters. But in this chapter, which is what we're going to focus on today, we will read about the behavior of agape love, and I said the behavior of agape love in relation to Advent. The title of my message this morning is Jesus, the Summation of Love. Jesus, the Summation of Love. We have been celebrating, and you can put that first slide up now. There it is there, okay, good. We have been celebrating and anticipating the Savior's coming during the Advent. These Advent messages have been delivered. Hope, where Senator Wanda challenged us to introduce our hope to our inspiration. Peace, where Junior Deacon Morgan told us about spiritual peace, when the inward and the outward peace come together. And last week, joy, when Junior Deacon Andrew told us if we want to stop church politics, we must have faith in God, and out of that faith, we will produce joy. Today, I am excited to talk to you about love. When we think of love, what is the first thing that comes to mind? For some, it may be your parents, your spouse, your children, your siblings, a family member or a friend, even a pet. Some of us may go to the autopilot and say, God or Jesus. All of those answers are good, very good. The reason why those answers are good is that it says you love outside of yourself. If you were to respond with, I love my car, my house, my jewelry, my hair, that love is not a lasting love. You're just using the word loosely. You love these things temporarily. The love is fleeting. We love our vehicle if it works. Just yesterday, I went to start my CRV and it would not start. It was no good to me. I needed to be someone at a place. I needed to be here at the church. I needed to pick someone up. It was no good to me if it didn't start. I didn't like it at that time. You love your house, but if you can't live in it or things start breaking down, then you don't love it that much, do you? And you know, the older our homes get, the more these things start happening. You know, rusty pipes need to be repaired. There's always a leak. Always something to take your money, right? Can I get an amen? Because I know. Just yesterday. We love our hair after the hairdresser does it. But the next day, not so much. Because we can't get it that same way that she had it. What's up with that, you know? So, what is love? What is true love? In the Dictionary of Theological Terms, the definition of love, or in Greek agape, and in Latin amor, is defined as a strong feeling of personal affection, care, and desire for the well-being of others. It is the primary characteristic of God's nature and the supreme expression of Christian faith in action. The Bible lists the characteristics of love in 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 to 8, which we will walk through together this morning. When we recognize what love is, it is easy to recognize what love is not. Second slide, please. So, let's read part of verse 1, which says, "Love suffers long and is kind." Jesus came to earth giving up his heavenly, worry-free home to dwell on earth among those who hated him. I'm going to say that again. Jesus gave up his heavenly, comfortable, worry-free home in heaven to dwell on earth with those who hated him. Jesus suffered through his life, knowing the truth, yet always being put on the spot to prove himself. He was tested by his parents, his family, his neighbors, and even his disciples, who wanted the Savior to deliver them, but they wondered if it was Jesus. Jesus suffered all his life knowing he was the truth that would set humankind free. He stayed the course. Think of it this way. What if you knew something that you wanted to let others know that would help them? The more you taught them, the harder it got. Some got it, and then you have to teach it again to the next crowd. Some of them get it, and some don't. Then you teach it again, and no one gets it. And then they start attacking you for even teaching it. And those you've taught stand by in horror, watching, afraid to even fight for you. You're on your own. That was Jesus before the cross. Jesus' suffering did not begin at the cross, where the physical suffering was so immense, but it began when he was born in that lowly stable. The next line of that scripture says, "Love is kind." Jesus is kind to you and I, even when we don't deserve it. Who wakes us up in the morning? Who looks beyond our faults and sees our needs? With mercy and grace, Jesus forgives us and is so loving and kind to each one of us. Love does not envy. I couldn't find any scripture that Jesus says he wants something that someone else has. Even when Satan tried to tempt Jesus in the garden, Jesus did not give in to Satan's schemes. Jesus did not seek any position over him, or even over Pharaoh or the Pharisees or the Sadducees. Jesus knew who he was. He was confident. He did not need to flaunt his position to feel important. He did not want what someone else wanted or had. There was no envy in Jesus. The next part of scripture says, "Love is not puffed up." Jesus was as down to earth as they come. It was not beneath him to touch a blind man, a lame man, someone with leprosy, to talk to children, men or women, to talk to people of all backgrounds. Jesus hung around with the sinner, the tax collector, doctors, fishermen, the outcast, the downcast, the widow, the single mom. Jesus could carry on a conversation with the rich and with the poor. Jesus was the real deal. Love does not behave rudely. Number 5. Jesus knew how to behave in public and at home. When his mother asked him to turn the water into wine, he did not humiliate her in front of the guests. He did what she said. When he called to the woman at the well, when he talked to the woman at the well, he went alone. He did not wait for his disciples to come with him. They could have embarrassed her. Jesus practiced what he preached. Love does not seek its own. For those of us who are Christians, we were forced to, here's a question. For those here that are Christians, were you forced to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Hands? Were you forced? No. The answer is no. Jesus does not force his truth on anyone. He wants you to accept him when you are ready. Jesus just happens to know when you're ready. Love is not provoked, and it thinks no evil. Going back to Satan again, Jesus had Satan's number, and he never gave in. Even in the garden, when Satan tried to tempt him while he was hungry, Jesus stayed strong. He could have used his power to do evil, but he did not. Love does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. When someone is going through a hard time, love does not kick you when you're down or celebrate when something bad happens to you. That is horrible for us to think about it like that. Besides, we're all subject to have things happen in our lives that upset us and especially take us by surprise. We who are blessed should be a blessing to others, helping others instead of talking about them. We never know when we will need someone to help us. And it could be that same person that you said or thought bad things about. Amen. In John 14, 6, it says, Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man or woman comes to the Father but by me. Practicing the love of Jesus, who is the truth, is the opposite of what the world wants us to do. Rejoice in the truth. If something is going well for someone else other than yourself, be happy for them. Remember, if they are doing well, then God is blessing them or allowing it. The last part of this passage is love bears, believes, endures, and hopes all things. With this kind of love, nothing seems to bother you. This love is lived out in everyday life. Life gets interrupted all the time. But with this type of love, it is prepared to go through it and believing that there is going to be a better day ahead. The passage ends by saying, no matter what, love will never fail. Third slide. God's love is so big, it will never, ever, ever fail you. So, let's demonstrate that love that Jesus gave. Next slide. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Next slide. God loved us enough to send Jesus, his only Son, to show us the way. Jesus, God, and the Holy Spirit are one, for those of you who don't know. That's the Trinity. Fourth slide. In other words, God came down to earth to check us out, basically. The incarnate God, or God in the flesh, came down to earth. The best thing you and I could ever do is believe in Jesus and start living an example. More than just a precious baby who came to earth to live among us, Jesus is our deliverer now as we wait for his return. Now we're waiting for him to come back. Next slide. This child who grew into a man was on a mission to teach us how to love one another. God loves all his children, and we're his children. That's you and me. Imperfections and all. Sometimes this road of life is not easy, but you don't have to travel it alone all by yourself. Jesus will lead you. Like Jesus, we will suffer when we act as witnesses for Jesus. Don't stop, though. Don't stop talking about Jesus. Don't stop witnessing for him. Keep sharing the good news about the love of God. We all want to become heirs. In Romans 8:17, it says, now, if we are children, then we are heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. Who doesn't want to live eternally with our Creator? Love is all over Jesus. Next slide. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. This is a gift that God gave us that we can share. We got a new command, though. And that new command, you can read it with me. I give you a new command to love one another as I have loved you, so that you must love one another. Powerful words and so true. If we loved each other, there would be no arguments, no fights, no bullying, no wars, no hungry, no homelessness. Everyone would have, and we would make sure no one was left out. We can't solve the big picture problems of the world. We just can't do it. But we know who can. It's God. And it's God through us. How does He do it? Well, He works on the heart. If we let the love of God come in, we will be wanting to help anyone with a need. There is nothing wrong with that. Also, we would not need or want anything back in return. And we would never talk about what we did to make someone else's life better. Paul stressed the importance of faith in loving one another. Love, backed by faith in God, can make great gains without the hassle. Because you now can let go, be everything God intended, allowing God to have His way. Next slide. Pastor Porter wanted me to pass a message on to you. It said, "It is so good that God allowed us to see, as we end 2016, the coming together, and just how strong we are in numbers as we enter 2017. Don't let the devil fool you. This is God's church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." We're going higher. That's Pastor Porter's word. We are going higher, and I believe it. Do you believe it, church? Amen. I believe it. Now, that's love, and that's Jesus. He is our example. Jesus is the summation of love. Last slide. Amen, church?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.